This is yet another Erlang demo, okay? Yeah, can't give you too many of these. Hope you're not too bored by them already. So, what I plan to do here is to run a system showing some of the properties of the Erlang system. Okay. So, on this window up here, I've started up an Erlang, and I'm going to start up a system that comes with it called Observer. It's a tool for introspection. So I can look at the system here, I can look what's going on in the system, et cetera, here for it. So I can, for example, look at the load. And if we look at the load here, it's doing very little. It's the only load you've got is the load server itself. So now let's try and run an application here. So now we're going to start up another system here. And this one we're running in LFE, okay, partially anyway. So now I just have to load in some commands. This is just defining some local functions in the LFE REPL. This is down here, you can see what the LFE mug looks like in ASCII graphics, right? The one out on the desk looks much nicer. Sorry? How do I make this thing bigger? Bigger, plus, right, we'll see if this works, shall we? Is that better? Yeah. On the other shell, I was just starting the observer system, so there's nothing much there to see. Can you see? Right. Okay. So now this is a little demo with spaceships. Okay. We will do one thing. Where are we? Oh, we'll take that later. So yeah, we'll go here. So now I can start the system. So now we're running in the LFE shell now. So now I can start the system and I can say how big I want the universe to be. So it's 500 sectors by 500 sectors, and we'll try running 2,000 spaceships on it. That's up there. As yet, you don't see anything because I actually haven't started the timer running to start the simulator. So now I can do a start run here, so I can run this. And we do a timing tick of 75 milliseconds. That's what this means. So now I'm starting the application here. And now suddenly all these 2,000 spaceships pop up on the screen and they're running. So each one of these is an Erlang process. The logic is implemented in Lua, running on it. So now what we want to do is now we want to look at this through Observer. So let's see, we go here and now I do nodes. I have to connect the nodes, and I have to connect to the simulator, which is called Sim at Rianut. There. And now I can connect. What happened? Yeah, now we go. So now I'm looking. Now my observer, which is running on one Erlang node, is looking at introspecting on the system running on the other Erlang node, and this is the actual spaceship simulator here. So we can see we're running. Bit difficult to see, but we're running 8 schedulers, one per core, and the system is automatically load balancing between them. Now these ships are very simple for them, and I can do a lot of stuff here. I can, for example, decide I would actually like to run on fewer cores. So now I can modify the system now. I've got to make sure I spell this correctly. So now I can say I want to run it on 6 cores. And if we go back here and look, it's now closed down 2 cores and moves all the processes from those 2 schedulers over to the other 6 schedulers. And if you noticed, you didn't see anything on the side while I was doing this. And I can bump it back up again if you want to. Now, this is pretty boring. So now we can run some other ships as well here. So I can set the first, where are we? We make this a run ship. I'll explain what this is in a moment. So I'll set the first 1,000 ships to become run ships. And now we'll see if you can see this. Hopefully you can see that some of the ships are turning green. I'm afraid I don't really know how to make this any bigger here. And the green ships have a different way of moving. The original ones just went in a straight line until they hit the edge of the universe and they bounced off. The run ships here, they have a different strategy. So when they come out to the edge of the universe, they start following the universe around. So you can see all the green ships coming around here. And if we go back to the load here, for example, we can see there was a spike in the load when I was loading in the code and reconverting all the ship functions. But if you notice, there was no in time. None of the ships stopped. Everything just kept working. There was a slight increase in memory because I've got new code running in here as well. So that's good. I can look at more things here in the system as well. For example, I can look at all the processes. I can click on a process here, and this is a ship process. I can get information about this process. And again, the observer is running on one node and it's looking at a system running on another node. That one? Yeah, just a minute. The load we're looking at here is of the Erlang system itself running on your schedulers. So they're running at about a bit over 50% load here. And this is the one down on the right is the load of the machine itself. So I'm running 2,000 processes. Each one is ticking every 75 milliseconds and it's recalculating its trajectory, what it's going to do. Now the thing is, the logic of each of these ships is written in Lua. So each ship is an Erlang process and it's getting information and timer ticks and stuff like this for it. We'll see if you're getting information from other ships as well, but it's all the logic's programmed in Lua. So we're now running three languages at the moment. So we've Erlang, we've got LFE, which is running in the shell, and we've got the logic written in Lua. So yeah, and I can change things. Well, we can go back, for example, we can go back to have eight cores. So I set the cores to 8 here. And now we notice it pops up the other two cores, moves processes across those using all of these. So all this load balancing is done automatically by the system. Now this is a game and it's pretty boring, right? And one thing with a game is you want to kill things. I mean, that's really what a game's all about, right? It's killing things, right? So let's make some ships into what I call attack ships. And we will make the last... We'll make 100 attack ships. So we will make, say, we'll call the last 1900 to 2000. The last 100 ships will turn into attack ships. Now they're going to turn red. An attack ship moves straight ahead. When it runs into a ship in front of it, it kills it. Right? It zaps it. So what we're going to see here, one is we're going to see explosions. I am not a graphics person, so an explosion looks like a tiny yellow square. Sorry, I don't do graphics. But we will see a lot of output coming in the shell here because every time a ship zaps another one, it's going to write out zap, and every time a ship explodes, it's going to go boom. I don't have a sound interface either, right? So we're seeing this one. So now we can do this. So there we see red ships, and now you see the red ships, where they're getting ships before, they're killing other ships. They're killing each other too. We don't discriminate. We kill anything, right? That's the Erlang way. We just happily kill everything. And now you see the ships are being zapped and boomed and stuff like this as well for it. And if we start looking at the load now, we can go up and look at the system here, and now we can see instead of the 2,100 processes we had, we only have about 1,700 at the moment. So we've killed about 300 ships already. And if we look at the load charts, we see the memory usage is going down, because every time you kill a ship, you're killing the process. So we're killing Erlang processes here, killing the ship for it. So the memory usage is going down. We see that the load is going down for it. I can now, for example, go back to 6 cores if I want to. We could probably go back to 4 cores and make it even more adventurous. And it just keeps going. So now we've turned off 2 more cores, and now we're running on 4 cores. And this will just keep on going, killing ships until basically almost they're all dead. So yeah, that's just a bit I wanted to show. Anymore. So, any questions? Do we have time? A quick question, perhaps, if anyone has one. Yeah. Nope. Not it depends. If one can kill the other one before the other one can kill it, then it'll die, right? Yeah, so this whole thing is running completely asynchronously. So I do have another example for those who want to see later what happens if you start doing synchronous communications between ships. You let it run for a while and everything locks, right? So of my 2,000 ships, I have about one ship that's not locked. Everything else just stops. Yeah, a question. It's not come online because I've been working occasionally to try and clean it up, but I'll try and put it on. When it comes, it'll be on my GitHub for it. So it just keeps... I want to make it slightly more diverse so you can program the ships in other languages as well. So you could then have some ships programmed in Erlang, some ships programmed in LFE, and some ships programmed in Lua, and they'll all be fighting each other. Yeah, the load's slowly decreasing for it, yes. Yeah. And the interesting thing is, I mean, this whole thing about the load balancing and using multi-cores, this is baked into the virtual machine, into the beam. I am not doing anything to tell it to use the cores. The system's doing it itself. I'm controlling it, saying how many cores I want it to use. But when I change the number, it's the one that's moving the processes between the cores to do this formula. It's the one that's handling the load balancing, for example. This is not something I have to worry about. I can worry about it if I want to. For example, I'm setting the number of cores here, but if I don't, the system just does it automatically for me. It will also, if the load goes down far enough, actually start to turn off cores if the operating system allows it. So trying to be energy conservative here. So now we're dying pretty. We need some more attack ships. I think that's the thing. I'll just change that, and we'll go. Then I'll leave over. Whoops. So we'll set 1,500. There won't be so many left now. So I'll just change these. So now we make more attack ships. Now we'll start killing things more again. And if we look on the load here, we see there was a slight memory bump when I was putting new code in. Okay, that's it. I'll unplug myself here.
Okay, so how many people were at the Idris talk yesterday? Half-ish? Okay. So in the talk we had, there was an example of writing type-safe printf. Yep. Is that better? So there was an example of a type-safe printf. So Idris doesn't have printf built in, but that doesn't matter. You can write it yourself. So it's kind of an example of using dependent types to do metaprogramming. So you have to believe me that this is an implementation. But because we've got dependent types, we don't really need a unit testing framework or anything. We can actually just write examples in our application and have it so that if it compiles, then our tests pass. So here's an example. We can have, say, printf of hello world equals hello world. And Idris will find proof, and this will only compile if that's true. If I come up here and delete this, we get a compilation error saying that's not the same. So it's actually running printf at compile time, so I could also do example of actually having a format string. So anyone want to guess what the output of this is? No. So that's printf working, and we could also write and give it something else. So this will be hello 42. And REFL just means that these things are equal. So we've written types, and we've proven that those types are correct, those types being just that these two things are equal. So we've got unit tests, but by using types and by providing proofs, and our program will only compile if those tests pass. So if we change the implementation, our program won't compile anymore. Okay, so whenever I show the printf, the first question I get is, this only happens at compile time, so it doesn't work with any strings that you get given at runtime. We can actually make it work at runtime, and we do get benefits from it. We do get the benefits of dependent types by even when we're getting user provided strings. So let's take a format. And if you look at our printf, it returns something of this interp format thing, which generates a type for us. You don't really have to worry about that. What we're going to do is do some I/O based on the printf function. I'm going to get Idris to generate a heap of code for me. So if we pattern match on the format, we will find out that the printf function, in the case that our format string was empty, we will find out that what we have is a function that's just a string. So we'll just output a string, right? We can actually verify this by putting an X here, and we'll get a compilation error saying that. So X is a string. So we actually know that X in this case, because we pattern matched on it, we've refined the information about this interp format. So we know that printf is going to give us just a string in this case. So what do we want to do in the case that we get a string from printf? If we want to actually run this printf function, print it. OK, so that compiled, so that's right. In the case that we get, we've got a percentage d in the string, what do we know about the function, the printf function? What's the type of the printf function in the case that you got a percentage d at the beginning of the string? Int to something. Yep. So if we can look at this down here. So it actually, yep, it's an int to something. So what we can do is get an int from somewhere. So we're gonna say something like, give me an int. Get an int. This actually be a string in this case. We have to do a little bit to make it into an int. And so we know that this function, this x here, is a function. And so we want to recurse, because we want to handle the rest of the format string. So what we have to give it is the function after we've provided an integer. So there's this dodgy function in Idris called cast, which doesn't crash. It'll just, if you provide something that's not represented as an integer, so if it's not just numbers, what it will come out as is zero. So it's a little bit dodgy, but we'll go with it. OK, so that compiles. Anyone want to guess what we want to do with strings? If you've got a percentage s? And what do we want to do with this? What is this function? What's the type of this function? String to something, yep. So just give it the string that we give it. And in any other case, we actually don't care about it, because we know, what's the type of, I don't know, this is probably not easy to guess what the type of this will be in the case that we get anything else. But it's just the rest of the format string. We don't actually change, you don't have to provide anything to it if it's anything else other than percentage D or percentage S. So we can just recurse here. There you go. So this is a function that will take in the format string, so the representation of the string, the underlying representation of the string, and do some I/O. And by using dependent types, we've been able to know what the type of this function is based on the format. So every time we pattern match on this format, we know a little bit more about this function. And in each of the bodies here, it's actually slightly different type. The type here and the type here of this x is slightly different in each of the bodies. So what we can do is write a main function. And run it. So we need to take the string, get out a format string based on that, and we can give it the printf function. Idris will also infer a value for this, so we can actually just put underscore there, and Idris will figure out what the hell we meant. Okay, so now that we've got that, we've written dependent types, and that's all cool, but we want to actually write a program that works. So we can compile the program and run it. Anyone want to give me a format string? Something a little bit interesting? what is that going to do? I don't know. So it asks for a string, OK. There you go. So at runtime, it's figured out it's passed the percentage s as like a format string, gone through the program that we wrote, which was to every time we see a format string, ask it to give me a string, and then we can run the printf function because we know in that case that it's a function from string to something. And so we keep running it, we keep running through the format string until we get to the end of the program and we print it out. And so we can do, this is not just made up, I can say percentage d, percentage s, and there you go. So we can actually use, like, depending types, we can actually do things at runtime. And it's not just a theoretical thing that we can only do certain things at compile time. We can actually use dependent types and get benefits at runtime. Thank you.
I have two things to show. One is around, one is specifically meant for beginners. Like in the morning, like I met a lot of people who were just get started in the function programming. So from my personal experience, I failed twice when I started learning Haskell. No surprise, like that's what everybody does. So, but once I find out that aha moment when I finally figure out what everything is all about, then I actually put that into some like kind of three steps. Like if you know these three steps, you can cover pretty much everything about functional programming. Those are the three steps I'm going to reveal today. Okay. So functional programming, we first start with, you know, modeling the domain. Like whatever domain that we are in, we just model that with the constructs which has been offered by the corresponding language. If it is any typed functional programming language, like we just use the corresponding record type, discriminated union choice, sum type, and everything put together, we define the domain. Whereas in case of dynamic functional programming language, we use hash map and all those constructs to define the domain. Once we define the domain, then we define functions which operates on the domain data, which we call it as lambda x. We define just functions which will operate on the data that you have, you know, created, and that this function is going to operate on the data that you have created in the previous step. The third and most important step is we just define the system itself by composing all the functions which we defined in the previous step. Those different operators are the key things that most of the people get confused, but the logic, underlying logic is just we are composing together and coming out with the system. So let me showcase that by showing a real world example kind of. So we are asked to model a chat application, and I'm going to talk through one use case called where we are, when a message got posted, we are persisting that in a database. Okay. So for this particular use case, what are all the domain information? HTTP request, which models the HTTP request which is being posted, the message itself, the error which may happen in the system, in the process, and a result type, which is when we are doing some operation, it can be either success or it's a failure. In case of success, the message itself is the result. In case of error, we are going to find out whether it is which error it is going to be. And the final thing is HTTP response. Now we modeled all the types pertaining to this particular domain. Next step is we need to define functions which operate on this The first thing is read request, which is going to read the HTTP request, and it's going to give you the message from the request. In case if there is any HTTP read error, we will be getting error. Then another function, validate, which is going to take the message and going to, you know, say whether the message is through the validation. If it is case of any error, we'll be populating the error field. So the create in DB is another function where it takes a message. It, again, it's going to give you a result. Either it can be a success again. In case of success, it is going to give you the message again back. Or in case if it is an error, it's just going to return an error. The final thing is write the response back to the HTTP endpoint, where we take the result and put that into a HTTP response. I'm not getting into the details here. I'm just defining you the functions which will, you know, do the operations in the pipeline. Once we did all those things, all we need to do is just compose. Those operators are different functions. We call all the terms, M word, and all those things will come into that picture. Like, but don't worry about all those things. Basically, what we are doing here is we are just chaining everything together in one form or the other, and then we are defining the system. And at the end of the day, the system is nothing but the HTTP, the function itself is a function which takes an HTTP request and gives a HTTP response. So this is the functional programming, like for a very new beginners, like this is the three things that you need to identify. Like, how do you define your domain in the underlying language? How do you define functions which operate on your domain? Then the last piece is, which is the most complex piece, is putting all these things together and coming out with the solution. Okay, this, if we crack these three things, you know, you can easily very well understand any functional programming language. Okay, this is around for the beginners, and since there are a lot of in the previous demo that we have seen the power of types, like you can point to any data source and get something. In F# we have a concept called type providers, where you can point to any data source and you can, you know, get a strongly typed access. And I'm going to showcase some of the examples. So there is a type provider for JSON. Like, I'm just pointing this JSON type provider to, is it visible? Okay, I'm just pointing this GitHub type to the remote data source, where I'm just pointing to the GitHub API. So I'm just executing this. Now I have GitHub API type in my system. So if I get the sample out of it, for all the HTTP, this is the sample HTTP response which is being returned by the GitHub API. For all these things, I will get IntelliSense. See here, emails, URL, emojis, URL. What these types are automatically created from the response. I didn't do anything. The library has taken care of all this compiler magic behind. You just point to the data source, it will create the types for you for free. And this is not, like, we can extend this to point to different data sources also. Like, for example, I'm just pointing to a different endpoint where we are getting the user information. So I'm just creating the type. Now this type can, you know, fetch user information from the GitHub in a type-safe manner. So I'm just defining a function where you just give the username, it will create the particular strongly based type for this function. So now I'm creating a type for Don Syme, who is the creator of F#. So his GitHub handle is dsyme. So I'm just executing that. Okay, I didn't execute this. So now I have this function. Just executing it. Now it got. So I can get his company name. He's working for Microsoft Research. So there also I'm just getting all these things, his bio, all this information. I'm just pointing to a remote data source. From the JSON response, I'm getting all the types for me. And these types, for example, date of birth, I guess. Okay, this is intelligent enough to track. If it is an integer, it will give you an integer type. If it is a date time, it will automatically convert it to a date type. If it is a GUID, again, it will create all these things. Exactly. Exactly. So here, for the very first time when you are providing this, right, this is compile time. So you cannot do this in, this is runtime. I created the types in my compile time. I'm executing, I'm using those types in the runtime. Yes, that's where you need to, when you are creating the type, you need to point to the right schema. Like you in the, when you are providing the, this URL, what you are telling to the compiler is, hey, this is my data you know, resource URL. Go fetch the URL and produce the types. And then you are, you now the type system is available. Then, yes, if the JSON response has changed. Yes, but it yeah. If it fails, that's good, right? Like this, that means the system itself is, it has to upgrade to talk to the new version of the API. So that's a thing that we are getting here. Yeah, most API will have the versions. Yeah, that's another thing. When the version is freezed, the response won't get changed. And we can extend this to any data which has a fixed schema. Like JSON, I'm using a CSV providers. I'm having a data here. It just shows ID, name, age, and email. So I'm just populating. I'm just pointing to this data source. Now I have the CSV provider with me. I'm just getting a sample out of it. If I want to print all the age, I'm just using this function. I'm just printing it. So it, oops. Oh, it's a sequence. Okay. Yeah, now it print everything, 28, 17, and 13. Sorry? When that is? Oh, wait. Oh, okay. So for the very first time you need, so that will the to, for the type generation. For the subsequent iteration, you don't need that actually. One. Yeah, it's at the compile time, it maintains its own, like it's that compiler magic is happening in the behind the scenes. So this one, again, this is also type safe. If I change age or maybe age to different fields, say age 2. I'm getting a compiler error here. Say the age has been changed, so I need to put age 2. Even I will get intelligence also, age 2. So this is the, yep. Yeah. There are two ways. If you are very sure that this, Naresh pointed out, if there is any fixed version that the under this version, this JSON response is not going to change at all, you can point to a version. Otherwise, there is another option where you can create a sample response and put that in as part of your code and refer that sample response in your flight system and then use that in your subsequent building. Okay? And this can extend it to my, like, you can think, like, how many of you will write a regular expression without referring to any sort of Google research? It's very hard. So what we have come out in F-Shop is like we have a regex type provider. All you need is just feed the regular expression into this regex type provider. I'm just loading it. So this is just to parse the phone number. Here, when I'm parsing the phone number, I'm just assigning some labels. The first three digits pointing to the area code. The last, like three and four, like last seven digits are phone numbers. So I'm just using the type match. I'm feeding all the values, and I'm putting dot phone number. If we put phone number dot value, it will give me the phone numbers, which is the second part. If I put dot area code again, see, you see the intelligence is coming up. So I will get the area code. Say if I change area code to say code, I will get a compiler error. So I need to put code here. So basically, if the underlying data schema is fixed, you can create type providers for that one. Here, this fixed is only it's going to be the code and the phone number. If the schema is fixed, I'm just feeding that to the type provider. The type provider creates the type for me. I can access this in a strongly typed manner. That's it. Thank you.
So I thought I would just do a quick demo of QuickCheck for you. What I'm going to show you is not the original Haskell version that Kuhn Klassen and I wrote a paper about a long time ago, but rather, So rather, I'm going to show you the version in Erlang that our company has produced. So now we can see that, right? Okay, so suppose we want to test the reverse function on lists. Really simple example. Here is how you might write a conventional test in Erlang. So this just calls reverse on a sample input and then matches the result against the expected answer. Okay, so this is how the vast majority of tests are written in industry, right? Where you perform a sequence of calls and then you check that you get the expected result. And if I go to the Erlang shell now, okay, can you see that? Yes. Let me just compile that module, and then I will run my test. And yes, it passed. So what I'm doing here is matching the result against the expected value. If it doesn't match, for example, if I were to put a 2 here, that'll cause a mismatch, then we get an exception. So my test, before I screwed it up, passed. So that's all very well, except that you have to think of the test cases you want to run, and that's not hugely interesting. So instead, what QuickCheck lets us do is write one test, except that we usually have to express the test differently. Right? So it's going to be difficult for me in general to predict the result of reverse without rewriting the function, and I don't want to do that. So what we do with QuickCheck is think of some general property of the function, like the fact that if we take any list of integers and reverse it twice, we end up with the original list. So this equals, it's just going to make a comparison between this and this. Okay, and now if I start QuickCheck, then I'll run that, and I'll just give it that property as an argument. It's just an Erlang function definition. And sure enough, now it's passed around 100 tests. If that's not enough for you, after all, 100 tests don't necessarily mean that it's true, but 10,000 tests do, don't they? So now we have a lot of confidence that that's really, really holds. And if we take a property that doesn't hold, like this one, that just says that if you reverse a list, you get back the original list, then, as I showed you before, if I run this one, by not working at all, what do you mean? That's true, but then this wrong property would pass, wouldn't it? Let's see if it does. No. Okay, and here you see this is the randomly generated list that failed the test. And you get some output as well from the equal saying, look, they weren't equal. And after shrinking, we get the simplest case. So that's a very simple example demonstrating this behavior. But I thought I want to show you something a bit more substantial. So I have implemented a very simple key value store. So let me just demonstrate it to you, show you that it works. This is Erlang, so often in Erlang I have to start things. I'll start the key value store. Let's insert a key of 1 with a value of A, and a key of 2 with a value of B. Okay, now, of course, I should be able to look up those values. So let's look up 1, it's A. Let's look up 2, it's B. And the other thing that we can do is delete things. So let's delete the key 1. Okay, and now if I look up 1, it's gone, so So Erlang, this code just returns false in that case. And if I look up to, it's still there. So as you can see, the code works. Now, something else which I can't show you in this time is I've built a specification in Erlang, a quick check specification that specifies how this should behave. But what I can do is run those tests for you. So let me, I think that's what I called it. Yes. Let me test the property. There we are. Passes 100 tests. And here, I'm getting a distribution of which commands appeared in the test. So you can see we tested insert about a third of the time, look up about a third of the time, and delete about a third of the time. The start and stop are outside the things that I'm gathering statistics on. So that's cool, but maybe I should run a few more tests. Let's test for 10 seconds. Oh, it doesn't always work. Now you can see up here, this is the first test that failed, randomly generated. It's actually 77 calls long, and something went wrong in this test case. A post condition failed. This last lookup returned false when it should have returned A. Now, here you can see both the strength and the weakness of random testing. The strength is that we found a bug that was certainly not obvious from an initial quick test. And the weakness is that we've got something to debug that is 77 calls long. Nobody wants to do that. Hence, quick check shrinking. After shrinking, we get this test, which does 5 insertions, a deletion, and a lookup that returns the wrong answer. OK, are 5 insertions necessary? Let's run it again. OK, this test also does 5 insertions, a delete, and a lookup. It's a different data, but of course, the initial random test was very different. But after shrinking, it's surprisingly similar. Let's run it again. OK, this time, we sometimes get this. We needed 6 insertions, a delete, and a lookup. And 5 insertions, a delete, and a lookup. So this 5 insertion case, this really is the smallest kind of example that fails. And so now you're seeing shrinking in action, and it's producing something much more interesting. Can you imagine writing a test by hand for your test suite that would look like this? I think not. So we might ask, how often does this property actually fail? And I've got something called, how often does it fail? Which just lets me measure that. So I'll run 10 seconds of tests, and now I made a very slight change to my code. And in a moment, it should tell us, here we are. This property passes 99.54% of the time. So it's less than 0.5% of the time that it actually fails. You need to run 200 to 250 tests on average to find a failing case. So that's how hard to find this bug is. And what is the bug? Well, I've also defined something that will just rerun the last test, but show us what's happening. So it's a key value store, I said, but how does it work? It uses ordered binary trees internally. So here are the trees that we constructed. And this, every time I change the tree, I'm drawing the tree before and after. So for that last test case that failed, this was the tree. I wonder if I could make this bigger. Oh yeah, look at that. So this is the tree that was constructed with 5 insertions. And that's the tree after doing a deletion. And I think the value we deleted was 36 at the root. So when you delete the root of a binary tree, it's a bit tricky, actually. You have to move some other value up to the root. And this has moved 0 up. And then it has to put the 34 somewhere. And it's put it here, to the right of 37. That's why lookup doesn't find it. OK, so this breaks the invariant on ordered binary trees, and so lookup doesn't work. So This is quite a complex bug. Deletion is hard to get right. We could now look at the code. We won't. But you can see that quick check is just immediately put in front of us, a minimal example that provokes the bug, and then we can take that test case and analyze it, and it's really not that hard to find the problem, which could have been very hard to find without that help. So that is, okay, that's pretty much the demo I wanted to show you. Of course, all of these were still small programs. So you might wonder, how well does the approach scale? I want to just quickly tell you about the largest project we've done, which was for Volvo Cars and involved testing AutoSAR software. This is software that goes that runs on every processor in the car. We were testing the so-called basic software. It's like the OS. And this was a project in which Cubic, our company, collaborated with Volvo Cars and with the Swedish standards checking body. So they certified that things meet standards, and with our help, they certified that various implementations met the AutoSAR standard for the basic software. We read 3,000 pages of specifications. The standard is long. We turned that into 20,000 lines of quick check code. So that's how much formal content there was there. We tested more than 1 million lines of C code from 6 different suppliers, and we found more than 200 problems, of which more than 100 were problems in the standard itself. And on those occasions when there was some comparable test code to compare against, ours was 10 times smaller. So the point of this is to answer the question, does quick check scale? Yes, it does. So that's it. If you'd like to know more, then I will be running a workshop on Sunday that will go through the tool that I demonstrated today and show in a lot more detail how to build quick check specifications that can do this kind of thing. Okay, thank you.
So this is all in the wrong order because my next talk in this same room, I'm going to be introducing APL, and I'm going to be showing you some code instead to begin with. But anyway, what I'm going to show you is something that came out of the APL workshop that we did last year, where at the end I said, you know, we've looked at the language. Does anybody have something they'd like to try and, you know, have me solve live? And Naresh had this data. That was the JSON file containing the schedule for last year's conference. So you can see there, I've loaded some code on the first line there, and then I've done a quad n get, we call it, where I read all the content of this text file into a variable. And then I've done a 10-100 reshape of input, so we have the first 1,000 characters in that file formatted into 10 rows. So I made a 10-row matrix just so we could see what's there. So you can see it's, you know, JSON, deeply nested JSON showing the what was happening that year. And then I think the challenge was, you know, format this in some kind of visible representation. So I wrote a function which did this. So you call it with the left argument, which is the day of the conference you want to look at, and that JSON on the right-hand side. And then it returned actually a 4-column matrix, APL array, where the first column was the starting times, and then what's happening in the three slots. There were 3 slots last year. So what I'm going to try and do now is trace this function. So I'm going to go back up to that line and hit Control Enter. And that brings up our tracer. So we can see the code down here. And I'm going to single step through it and then try and show you some of the intermediate data, just to give you an idea of sort of what it's like a day in the life of an APL programmer. I think this took about an hour from start to finish, from I got the data until we had the finished program. Okay, so I have a function here called format, which I've called the right argument. Inside the function is called omega, the last argument. So here I'm saying from JSON omega, dot into that and get the object within that called conf schedule sessions indexed by the left argument, which was the day. So I'm extracting a piece of of information out of that. So I just type shed here. We don't sort of have a variable watch window because in APL it's more common to just type expressions. So you can use the APL language not just to see the value of something, but to execute expressions on it and see what's inside. So this is just a JSON object. That's not very interesting. Now, if we look at the first one of these, and then I call something called nameless class 2. So give me all the variables in there. Why didn't that work? Oops. Let's see if this works. That worked. So that's odd. Typing this in direction. That's just going pear-shaped. Anyway, I was just going to look at the first element there. I can't figure out exactly what's gone wrong in the demo here. But I've written a little helper function here. This curly bracket thing is to extract all the properties of a given name from what is an array of the schedule slots. So here I create 5 variables. We'll take a look at one of them. Time slot, for example. That's all the times for the slots that were scheduled in that session. I've got something called track, which is this list of strings, track 1, track 2, or a star if it went all the way across. And I'd like to translate that into something numeric. So here I say, look up track 1, in the list, track 1, track 2, track 3, this iota symbol here says, take this data and do a lookup, returning the index of each item found. And then the 4 residue here is going to convert anything which isn't in that list into a 0. So that line of code gives me now my variable track looks like this. I've got a 0 if it spans all the tracks. Otherwise, I have a track number. Now I'm interested in doing a little bit of work on the times. So I convert the time slot variables into numbers using minus or hyphen and colon as separators, field separators, and then I extract the 4th and the 5th column of the result that I get out of that. So if I just hover over HHMM here, you can see it's a 2-column matrix with the hours and minutes. And then I think this is actually unnecessary, but I thought at the time I wanted to do some arithmetic on it, so I convert that using base value representation. I say, interpret this as a number base 2460 and give me the number of minutes since midnight. So I now have minutes since midnight. And then I take the unique values of that and sort it so that I have the sorted start times minutes since midnight. And now I want to initialize my output matrix. So I take the number of starts that I have and the max reduce of the track number plus the span, which is how many tracks a session spanned, because I think there were some that spanned 2, where 2 tracks were combined into one room. So output now is a 3-column matrix. You can't really see that here. It says in very small letters here. It's 21. We had 21 different start times, and 3 was the maximum slot number. I look up the start of each session in the list, the sorted list of starts, and that gives me the row number where I'm going to insert some data. I compute the column by taking the maximum of 1 and the track number, because I don't want to get an index error by trying to index with 0. And then I have the span here where I do iota each, which generates the numbers 1 to n for each one of those. And then I add those together. So I end up with something called col. If we look at row, we can see that the target row and column that each one of the slots is now going to go into. I pre-initialize the matrix by inserting left arrow ASCII art into the matrix for the sessions that span more than 1. So we're sort of starting where they start and then plus however far they go. I've actually put a bit too many of these in, but it doesn't matter because I'm going to overwrite them here. By indexing into the output with the row numbers and the track numbers, the 20-fold each of the titles, which were also in one of the fields. And now we can see we're starting to get the end result here. So we have a 21x3 matrix. Finally, I want to prefix them with the times. And I do a -8 take of each of the times. So that gives me, if you remember what that looks like, it's an ISO formatted date. So I take the last 8, and then I do a -3 drop of each of those. So I lose the minutes. So times becomes this thing here. And then the result of my function is the times concatenated with that matrix. And we're done. And so that took about an hour to develop. And there are no loops in that. I think you'll agree it's a very different way of thinking about data. But once you get used to it, it's very, very highly productive way of doing software development. Yeah, so that was that demo. Any questions about that? Otherwise, I have a video I can show you of an APL application in action. I think those of you who were here 2 years ago may have seen it already. Should I do that, or any questions? Yes? What's it used for? That's a good question. The people who pay money to use it, significant money to use it, are nearly all doing financial applications. A typical APL application is a portfolio management system. So doing risk analysis and reporting on large collections of financial instruments. And the big advantage there is that, I mean, this code may look strange to someone who has a background in computer science, but to somebody who's coming from a mathematical or engineering background and has learned math, and we'll look more at that after the break, this is actually a more natural way of sort of translating mathematical problem statements into programming. So most of the people who use APL are not software engineers. They're sort of, I think I said 2 years ago, any kind of engineer other than a software engineer. It's a little bit weird because the typical APL programmer, I think, is a physicist or a mathematician who got hired by a company doing financial software and retrained to work on finance rather than physics. You know, I think the algorithms in a lot of physics are identical to finance. They're pretending that you can use the same algorithms to describe what happens in the financial markets as you get in physics. No energy loss and stuff like that. Yeah. No, I mean, there's a derivative of APL called K, KX, KDB, which is a reduced instruction set APL, which comes with a very high performance inverted columnar database. That's used for real-time trading. Our APL system is used for, you know, systems that need high performance. This kind of software scales very well. You can deal with very, very large quantities of data because there are no loops, even though it's interpreted. I mean, this same code would work on a schedule with, you know, hundreds of thousands of items. And that allows our interpreter to do a very good job of it because it's not going around interpreting in loops. Yeah. I think the highest performance system we have is curiously in Sweden also. It's a patient journal system. So I think about half of Sweden's hospitals by patient count are using a system written in APL for the real time, you know, in the hospital, in the emergency ward. And the reason that system works so well is, again, it was written by a nurse who had a friend who could do a bit of programming, and they approached it from the user perspective rather than starting with a star schema database decomposition. So they have a system with sub-second response times rather than, you know, taking hours just to log in, which I think is typical for hospital systems. Yeah. I should stop because both Roger and I are doing talks later, and there's a full day workshop tomorrow. So, do you want to see the video, or do we have how much time do we have? So this is not a typical APL application, I have to admit. But it's a lot of fun. It's written by a Finnish user of ours who got hold of the EU released public data about mapping, made it free, and then they had a competition for writing applications in the public domain. The data's in the public domain. You have to pay to use this. It's a game, essentially. So he wrote this game in APL. Now we need, do we have sound? So apologies to those who saw this already. At our user meeting last week, celebrating 50 years of APL, we had a 3D motion engine, a simulator, hooked up to this game in the outside in the break area. So people were riding this thing in a speedboat doing 50 knots. He claims to have the best wave simulations of any game, any maritime game. Working with a professor at the University of Helsinki to get Baltic waves exactly right. Now, of course, that wasn't entirely written in APL. The shaders running on the graphics card were not written in APL. But the wave, you know, all of the physics was done in APL. Just the rendering was done on the GPU. Okay. But that's not a typical APL application. You can also do that in APL. All right.
I'm not so confident about the whole blow your mind type of goal, but I'm going to try, right? So how many people have tried Erlang? How many people have not used it in a real project because it doesn't have the libraries you need? Not a lot, okay. So I've been doing it for about 10 years. I got exposed to it around 10 years ago. And most projects where I've ended up not using Erlang, at least in the initial days, were because I needed stuff that was available in other languages very, very easily and had to be written from scratch in Erlang, right? And I've definitely come across a bunch of people with that problem. There was somebody, a gentleman yesterday, giving a talk with exactly this this issue. So my goal here is to just show a trivial way of literally bringing in other languages into the Erlang system, right? And the way it works is this. So in Erlang, there's this construct called a port. And it allows you to essentially spawn a subprocess, an OS level subprocess that you have control over and can, because you're spawning it, you have control over the standard input, standard output, but you also have control over, you know, other file descriptors. So typical approach is that you choose file descriptor 3 as input to that external program and you choose file descriptor 4 as output from that external program, right? So now, with very little code, and it's about 100 lines of total code, right? If you put that in place, then you get access to all sorts of libraries and all sorts of languages. In some cases, it's worth the trade-off. In some cases, it's not, right? So if something's in your critical application performance path, then you probably don't want to jump off to another runtime and come back. But then there are several use cases where the developer productivity is worth doing that, right? So if you can get all the nice distributed systems, concurrent programming benefits of Erlang in most of your application, and whenever you need to jump off to something and still save time and develop the whole thing, it's kind of nice, right? So this is the idea. You can do this for any number of languages. I'm going to show it in Ruby. And the way it works is there's an Erlang part written, an Erlang process that is managing or controlling the external program. The external program also needs a little module that's interfacing with the Erlang part, right? There is a predefined protocol in Erlang around how you should do this. The predefinition in that protocol is that if you open such a program, then you can send it messages in two ways. You can send it messages as packets, or you can send it messages as a stream. And the approach I've found successful, I found to be successful for this kind of setup is packets. And when you send those packets, you can say that every packet is prepended with the length of whatever your message is, right? And in my case, right now, the messages are going to be simple RPC calls, right? Call this procedure for me and give me the return value back. And I'm going to block on those calls, all right? To start with, at least. But what I will do, though, is I will do this in the JVM, and I'm running the JRuby jar so I can run Ruby inside the JVM. Just because I don't like the verbosity of Java. All right, so let's do a little example, and that should get us started. That takes a little bit of a second. But any questions about the general idea so far? Jar compilation can, Oh well. Okay, so the example I'm going to do is, let's start with something as simple as map. So in this scenario, what I'm doing is first just starting a little port program, which does my math for me, which sets up that interface for me. So what's going on here is I started a Java jar, which in turn has my little program, right, that I wrote. And so it started now, and the next thing I'm going to do is do a simple math example, right? So I'm adding two numbers, and the math is happening inside Ruby. So I'm invoking the program from Erlang, the math's happening inside Ruby, and I get the result back. Never do this in a real system, right? There's no reason to. But it's a decent example to sort of get things started. It worked, right? And I could repeat it with other numbers, and it would still sort of do the trick, right? So once you've written those 100 reusable lines that I were talking about, then doing this for any number of use cases looks just like this, right? So I'll make this a little bit bigger. So there's some little code going on in the background that's enabling this, but the function I wanted to expose was add. I wrote a little module called my math port. I included a mixin in Ruby that I've already written, and I'll show you in just a second. And I wrote a little function that allowed me to add numbers together, right? So this worked, right? But let's make it a little bit useful, things that you can't do in Erlang or would have to write libraries to do in Erlang. And there are libraries available, so let's try and use some of those. So let's maybe try PDF generation, right? So there's a Ruby library called Prawn, which allows you to generate PDF documents. So let's try doing that. So my example is going to look very, very similar. Oops, where did I lose my window? Oh, there it is. All right, so in this case, I'm now, instead of starting my math port, I'm starting a PDF port, which is a, just that other program that you just saw. And now instead of calling the math command, I'm going to call a PDF port command. I think my function was called generate, right? And let's say I want to give it a file name, say hello.pdf, and I want to put some messages in it. Right. All right, so first time you run this, it may take a little while. More than usual, because this is when the new process is being spawned. But after that, it's pretty fast. So I can do this repeatedly with different values and do that pretty fast. Let's just quickly see if it actually worked. I close my other window, but let me just get to that in a second. I messed up my terminal a little bit, I'm sorry. All right, so this is my hello.pdf, just so you guys know that I'm not tricking you. I'll do this again. Right, and if I, alas, there's my hello.pdf, let me just open it. Right, and there's hey funconf. So that's kind of cool, right? So now I can, if Erlang has a PDF library, but if you go look at it, you don't get a lot of confidence. It was last updated like a few years ago. Nobody's maintaining it. On the other hand, the Ruby library is being actively maintained, being used in a lot of production projects. You get, you know, a little bit of confidence about using it. And it's a useful tool when you're trying to convince team members who are, you know, who make that argument of, well, why are we going to this system where we'll have to write a whole bunch of libraries, right? So let's take the example sort of in line with the goal of trying to blow your mind. Let's get a little bit crazy, and let's do this scenario. So because I'm calling stuff inside the JVM can run so many different types of programming languages, right? So I'm going to pull one in with the Rhino runtime that runs JavaScript. And my goal here is that I have some data in Erlang, and my user has given me some JavaScript to run in the context of that data, right? And now to do this in Erlang, I would have to write a full JavaScript interpreter, right? Or I give up on Erlang and I say, okay, I'm going to just live in Java for this particular setup, right? Either of those scenarios. But this is middle ground, and it's most of the time acceptable. There are some performance trade-offs in terms of going to another runtime, but in scenarios like this one, where your goal is to do something sort of external to the core of the system, let me not say that, right? I'm making assumptions, but in my case, it was a peripheral entity that wasn't time critical. It wasn't critical that in a certain time window this should get executed, right? So in that scenario, it makes sense. So what I'm going to do now is execute a JS port that I've written, right? And I'll show you the code in just a second. But this time, I'm going to start a JS port program, and this time, and I will run a, so this line of code is interesting. So what I'm doing here is, okay, the piece of JS code is A into 2, right? What is A is data from data that the Erlang world knows about, right? So somehow I know that A is 100, and I need to send that context over to Ruby, and then over from there down to the Java world, and then from there over to JavaScript, right? And then run that code in that context. So let's try, let's see if that works. And then I will show you how. Sorry, I keep switching windows. Right, so it did seem to work. All right, so what did it take, right, to pull this off? Let's look at the port programs. We looked at the math program already. It was very simple. This is just dependency type things, right? The key here is this mixin, which is bringing in that behavior. And that mixin defines this start function, which what it does is, remember the Erlang program started writing stuff on file descriptor 3 and reading output from file descriptor 4. And what the start method will do is it will interact with those two file descriptors, set them open a pipe, and then start dealing with them, right? So that's what's going on underneath. Let's look at our PDF example. Again, same idea. I mix in the RPC port mixin, and then I just define a little function. I had another example here to draw a little graphic, but you know, I forgot about it. And then this is the JavaScript code, right? And what's nice about this is that it literally is 15 lines of code that I can set up, and now I have a JavaScript runtime I can occasionally call out of my program when I need to, right? Of course, the hard part's done by the folks that develop Rhino, but it's nice to use, right? So that's what our programs will look like, and you can end up writing a whole bunch or a library of these if you need to. So what does it take? On the Ruby side, it needs a little mixin. The way you do mixins in Ruby is that you define this module class methods thing, and you define a function which is invoked every time the include instruction is called inside a module, right? And so what that does is it sort of mixes in every method in that module, right? And remember, we call the start method. The start method is essentially opening in I/O on file descriptor 3 and opening in I/O on file descriptor 4, making sure they're in sync. If it receives a sig pipe, I stop stuff. And the reason for this is that's what Erlang will do if it's dying, right? So if it's dying, it will send a sig pipe over to that process it's controlling, right? And then I just loop over. And this stuff is just sort of, so at the two ends, I one end serialize my RPC call, the other end deserialize it, and you can use whatever protocol you want to do the deserialization. I found message pack useful because it's available across languages and seems to work most of the time, unlike a lot of other alternatives. But you can use anything you want. So this is about 60 lines of code on the Ruby side. And if you switch over to the Erlang end of this, it's another 60, 70 lines of code. And what it is a little process that is doing, it's following certain standards Erlang has defined around monitoring this little port program. So when stuff goes wrong, you'll know because you'll get an exit message or you'll get an exit status message, right? Those kinds of things are handled here, down here. The crux of that RPC call is over here, where I send a message over to, whatever data I have, I pack it with my serializer, and I send the message over to my port, right, over here. And then I sit and wait for a response until I get a response, which is why I said I block, right? I don't have to block, right? And that's my last statement, and I'll leave you at that. A more complex version of this could essentially set up both these parts as routers, right? So JVM has actor libraries. Erlang's already process driven, so you can spawn a little actor manager, which, based on whatever message that comes in from the Erlang end, routes to the JVM routers, right? Or JVM actors. And the JVM actors can respond back to a central person, which is, again, the port program. And that program, when the message is received on the Erlang side, you route based on some kind of addressing standard or address standard, right? But once you have that set up, you essentially have a slave JVM that you can do whatever you want in, right? Database connection handling. So we use it at our company to do connections to Hadoop, for example. So we do Hadoop jobs from time to time, and Hadoop libraries are mammoth. You don't want to reinvent that wheel, and it's nice to be able to go do that on the JVM and come back and be in the Erlang world. And so that's my little presentation. I hope it's useful and gives you some value in arguing that point about there are no libraries. Thank you.
If you have not, that, okay. So have we, only a couple. So that's great, because there are a couple of demos which I'm going to run, and the first one is going to be a replay of what he showed in the Erlang User Conference last month, which was kind of, it blew me away. I'm not committing that it's going to be the same impact, but it was kind of very cool what Erlang could do. I mean, although it's obvious what it can do, but from a user point of view, there are so many things which are available but needs to be connected, and only once the pieces come together, it kind of looks awesome. So, hope the net connection holds up, but yeah, I'm going to. Is it better? Is it good now? Part of the screen is cut off. I don't know why. So what we have is, I've kind of downloaded stuff. Let's see if I can make the net happen, but I have one pre-recorded session. I can run through it if it doesn't work, but Reba 3 is a very cool tool for building stuff and packaging for Erlang. You should definitely try it if you are an Erlanger or if you want to try Erlang after this demo. So Reba 3 is this tool. Erlang is already installed on my system. What you need is a, what is that? Okay. I hope it doesn't get too big. Okay. So what I have here is a config, a simple config, which just talk about the plugin. This is a copy of Fred's work, which he had done, and I kind of asked him after the demo for my presentation over there. But so he said, okay, he gave me all the permissions. So I believe we should be okay me using here as well. So this is a plugin. Basically, what it actually indicates is you have a plugin system where you can have templates and you can import templates, which for convenience, basically, which I'm going to use. So there are only two files in this folder. One is the Reba 3 application or the script, which will help us in building stuff and using the plugin. The other is the basic Reba 3 configuration. So let's try this. So let me make a new CRUD project. It's what is that? If I move my window, I will not be able to see on my screen. That's okay. Great. Is it better? Is it okay? I just created a CRUD project. I'm going to create a handler, new CRUD handler, say some fruit, doesn't matter. Let's create another one. Let's stitch up the new handlers into the router. Let's build it. That's when it's checking out all the dependencies automatically based on the template it downloaded, which I'm going to show you in a while what are the dependencies for this project. So there are numerous ways you can actually define the dependencies. One is GitHub, the other is local file repo. There are other, you can do any kind of version control. Primarily, this tool is pretty smart to go to a whole new level of packaging and releasing. Also for embedded kind of deployment, which I made one of a project called Unikernel for, I used the RumpRun Unikernel for packaging Erlang, making a Erlang microkernel. So Rebar 3 was again helping me in packaging, which I'm going to show you in part because that's a big demo, so I don't want to show the whole part, but gist of it. Using Elixir in the background, but yeah, so it's getting all the dependencies, building it. So there's nothing. Okay, so there is some C part for optimization, but you could use alternative libraries for the non-NIF portions of the demo. So we have the project ready now. So let's just run this. It's up and running. Let me just pull up the browser. So it's the familiar swagger that we have automatically for the resources that we created. So as you can see, there are a bunch of them. You can make queries, which say you want to get. I don't know if you can. Okay, let me pull that screen down so that you can see them side by side. So the response, there's no 404 because we didn't create one. So let's go ahead and add something there. Let me just try it out. Okay, the content is created. So I can do a get again. As you can see, the screen below, you are seeing whatever the action is happening. Live action, which in the logs for the cowboy. So now you get the response body. I mean, like there's a similar thing. You can delete the resource as well, which is simply just, yep, so the content is deleted. Now I try to get it again, no content. Yeah, great. So this is pretty cool, but so why stop here? I mean, like you can do multiple stuff, and one of them being running tests, which is definitely very important. So I didn't write any tests, so let's see what happens. By the way, behind the hoods, if you were to check out this repo, you will find out the when the project is created. So it's using proper, which kind of based on quick check. It's using the quick check way of property based testing. Just that is open source. But all everything comes. So, like you can see, there are the tests are running, and so if I were to open Wireshark, you could see that there are some messages going back and forth in the local host and see that in action. But yeah, I don't have Wireshark installed, unfortunately. OK, so without even writing a single line of test, is he able to get 100% in routers? And even as you can see, the various other subs, or like you can see the 100% model coverage, which is kind of neat. So for any kind of REST deployment, this is kind of really awesome, and you get everything. And it, this doesn't stop here. You can actually go further and look at matrices, which is another very important piece of. Oh, I'm not running the application. Yeah. Okay. So there's none because I stopped it earlier. So let's do some stuff again. So see how that gets updated. So you're creating some content. Okay. So I have something here, and you can look at what happened. Yeah, so this one, and if you do it again, it changes, kind of very neat. You suppose having to do something with orange. It dynamically expands, so basically pretty much anything. Then you have statistics. It's using Folsom library, in case you're wondering what, okay, I don't know if you can see it. Okay, so so by default, the system is actually giving you much more matrices than you actually need, but yeah, you can choose to disable some of them if you want to, but this is kind of very critical in a production system, so you can, okay. There's one more, I'm forgetting that URL. Okay, system and memory. These are, So it's kind of lot more verbose and capturing a whole lot, but this would be better. So these are Erlang memories and processes for that matter. How much memory processes are taking, the amount of memory used by atoms and code. So if you want to just pull it and capture it in your measurement tool, Nagios or anything for that matter. Okay, I think. So I had more stuff to show, but unfortunately we are running out of time. So if you want, you can catch me. Okay, maybe a last bit, which I probably already have set up, which is kind of microkernel stuff, which, okay. Okay, fine, yeah. Okay, fine, that's okay. So I just wanted to show an Elixir demo which was using the Erlang microkernel, but it's going to take a while, so we can do it later on. That's all.
Things that I hope will blow your mind, and like a glimpse of the internals of the language as well. So the first factoid is that Julia is secretly a Lisp. So if you start the prompt with a dash dash Lisp, you get a Lisp prompt. It's called FemtoLisp. It is what the parser for Julia is written in. So we can invoke the parser here. So that's a Julia expression passed in FLisp. And as you can see, the expression is secretly a S expression. So, this is the Julia REPL. If I do 1 plus 2, it's going to say 3. But if I don't want to evaluate it. I can quote it with the syntax, and it returns me an object which represents the expression 1 plus 2, and it has a head, which is called, and then args, which is plus 1, 2. Plus is the function being called, and the rest of the args. So since we can represent Julia code inside Julia, we can obviously have hygienic macros. I'm going to show you one of them that I just made up. That I usually show because it's easy to understand. So what's happening here is this macro is taking an expression and keeping the first argument as it is and reversing the rest, right? And it's also keeping the head. So the way you call a macro in Julia is with the @ prefix, because it's kind of nice to have the separation between when you're calling a macro and a function. So what should be the result of this? It should be, any guesses? Flip 2 minus 3? 1. Yeah, that's correct. So what it's basically doing is it's flipping the arguments 2 and 3 and passing it to 1, or passing it to minus. So we can see what it expands to using this function called macro expand. So as you can see, it's 3 minus 2. So that's how expressions are represented inside Julia. And the next thing I wanted to show is how does 1 plus 2.0, to make things trickier, actually work, right? So if I look at the type of 1, it's an integer. If I look at the type of 2.0, it's a float 64. In most languages, the language spec itself would define a way to promote these numbers to float 64 and then add them. But in Julia, this is actually defined as part of the standard library. And I can look at how it actually works. I have this nice macro called @edit, to which if I give any expression, it's going to take me to the method that is invoked when I call 1 plus 2. 1 plus 2.0 is what I wanted to call. So this is the method that gets invoked for an abstract type, two number types for which a more specific plus method is not defined. So it just says that promote the arguments and then do plus on it. There's actually a nicer way to step through code in Julia using this package called Gallium. It's the debugger. So I can say enter 1 plus 2.0, and it will take me to that line first. It takes a couple of seconds in the beginning because it's compiling everything. So that's the line. Let's step inside. Again, the conversion mechanism is just a generic function called convert, which takes the type, which is the promoted type of T and S, and then a value, and then converts it to the promoted type. So that's how promote works. Let's step in. Actually, we'll not step in further, but I want to show you that there are many steps involved in that getting done, right? But the Julia's just-in-time compiler is smart enough to remove most of the abstractions that were created to just make the promotion mechanism work. So if I say @code_LLVM, it's going to show me the LLVM IR it's going to execute. So if you see here, it's just a FAD instruction, which is the fastest it can do. So I can also see the code native expression. So Julia sort of allows you to dive down into your code, to down the rabbit hole and actually look at what instructions get executed. So another cool demo I had is, I'll just take like 2 minutes on this. It's an APL. Oh, right, yeah. So this one's not, I guess. It's a APL interpreter in Julia. So we have string macros. So you say APL and pass it a string, and it's going to evaluate that using the APL interpreter. And the nice thing about this is that it just generates an AST, and then you can call that with Julia values like this. And if you look at the code LLVM of that, that's also as good as just doing it in Julia. And there is this compute operator in APL. So I can say minus commute, and it becomes flip of minus. So even if I do minus commute, it's going to generate code which is aggressively inlined, in the sense that over here, if you see, it's percentage 0, percentage 1. Here, it's percentage 1 and percentage 0. And it's not doing any more allocation to do the flipping. And this inlining applies till like 6 levels of the flip operator without me having to do anything in the interpreter itself. So I guess that's my demo. Thanks.